It is always a privilege to stand with the God's word, and we praise the Lord that we are able to sit before God's presence under his feet with the scripture. Bible is the one that teaches who Jesus is. It is a scripture that taught us about how we are saved, or how we need to be saved. The scripture is the one who that taught us about the hope that we have for the future. So for us, the scripture is sufficient for our doctrine and practice. And so we value it and we take it as very serious, and we thank God for the privilege to understand the scripture also. So many people in the world, they don't have a portion of the Bible even now. And many people don't know how to read. Many people not able to comprehend what things are read to them. So, but we have the privilege each time we come before the Lord, and we can have the Bible and God's word, the infallible, eternal, inspired word of God in our hands, more than one. And we are able to understand it also. It is in our own languages. And we thank God for that privilege. So we look into the scripture. So please go through as we, you know, study or meditate upon God's word this morning again. We look into God's word today from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 13 through 16. If you have a Bible in any format, whether it's digital or paper or, you know, anyway, I would encourage you to open to that portion as we walk through this scripture portion. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 13 through 16. And what we look into today is about, we are going to talk about or learn about our identity, our address in this world as pilgrims and strangers. So the title will be Pilgrims and Strangers. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 13 through 16. Let us read God's word together. All these people were still living by faith, even when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. We talk about faith at different occasions. And remember that living by faith, that is what the Bible called for us, the way that we should live. Living by faith. It is not only just a theory. It is not just a concept. It is not just that on the paper. It is a radical way of living in this world. Living by faith is a radical way of approaching things. So we live with a different standard, and we live with a different way of thinking and different perspective. So we don't boast in our success, or we are not lost with our tragedies either, because we live with a different perspective. So when you look into these people, the people those who are mentioned over here, how did they live? What did they went through into their lives? Look at that in chapter 10, verse 32 onwards. We see there is this description of these people. What did they suffer in their lives when they saw the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ into their lives? And how did they live their life? And what did they endure into their lives? We read there in chapter 10, verse 32 onwards. Remember those earlier days after you have received the light. That means you are enlightened, your eyes were opened to see who Christ is. When you stood your ground in a great contest in the face of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. Another times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You symbolized with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property, because you knew that you yourself had better and lasting possessions. Why did they endure? You know, all these things are listed over there. They were persecuted. Their property was taken. They are beaten up. They are, you know, publicly ridiculed. Nobody believed them.
And all these things they went through, and when they going through those things, they were helping and supporting and encouraging the other people. How did they do it? Look at that verse 34, the last verse over there, verse 34. How did they endure it? It says that verse 34 says this, because you knew that you yourself had better and lasting possessions. I'll read it from other versions actually to understand a little more. The Phillips translation says, for you knew you had much more solid and lasting treasure in heaven. The NKJV says this, you had a better and enduring possession. The contemporary English version says this, because you knew you had something better, something would last forever. You know what is that? I think that is a brief description of heaven. Something better and something is going to last forever. Why did these people suffer? They didn't get everything that was promised. They didn't get everything. They were not recognized or rewarded by this world. But how did these people, in the midst of suffering, how did they endure it? Because they knew, they convinced, they are admitted, and they knew this. There is a better and lasting place. That is what heaven is all about. So these people, we talk about these people, verse 13 of chapter 11. All these people. Who is all these people? Abel, who offered a better sacrifice. Noah, who built the ark. Abraham, who left his comfort. And Jacob and Isaac and Joseph. All these people that is listed in Hebrews chapter 11 are all the characters of the Bible in the Old Testament. How did they live? All these people. What did they do? They were still living by faith even when they are dead. These people lived by faith when they are alive. Now still they are alive. How? By faith. That is what they are doing. How did they live it? What is the characteristics of these people? And I believe that you and all of us are same journey over here. We all are going to go through this, and this is not our permanent home, our eternal home, if we are waiting for that. So how did these people live? There are four or five things. Let us look into that. Their characteristics of these pilgrims. How did they live it? Number one, what did they do? They says that they trusted the providence of God. They trusted the providence of God. You know, you will not see the word providence much in the scripture actually. There is only few places only you see that word providence. Or the providence of God. But what it is then? The providence of God. The providence of God is coming in English. You can divide that word in two. Or in the word provision. That you can divide into two. Pro and vision. In the providence, it can be divided into two. Pro and video. So it is like a foresight. It is able to see things before. Or the meaning of that word of providence is God's gracious oversight of the universe. God's gracious oversight of the universe. God's grace is his gift towards us, his oversight. With the God, when we talk about the doctrine of the providence of God, this is what it says. God cares about the tiniest details of our life. God cares about the tiniest details of our life. Sometimes we don't feel that. We don't see that. You know, things goes in our lives, we don't see that. But with God, there is no big or no small at all. Remember that. There is no big. God knows every sparrow that falls on the ground. God knows every star by name. He calls them by name. He knows every fish in the ocean. There is nothing big or small with God at all. That is what the providence of God. Whether you believe it or not, that is what the scripture teaches about the providence of God. There is nothing big or small. God is concerned about the tiniest details of our life. Not only God created us and just going to take care of us. No, every day, every moment, everything that happens in our lives is by the knowledge of God. Either God allowed it or God knows it. There is nothing in between at all. Everything that happened. The providence of God. But we may not see that all the time. But you look back sometimes, because in our tiny mind, we will not be able to see everything as it is. We talk about Elimelech and Naomi yesterday. You know, we don't see that what happened to Naomi. What happened to Elimelech. Elimelech didn't see that. What is going to see? When you take the scripture as a whole, you see the Bible is all about the plan of redemption, right? That is what we see from Genesis chapter 3, verse 15 onwards. Men failed and rebelled against God. God gave them a promise, and that promise continues throughout the scripture. That is what Abraham, that is what about Isaac, that is what about Jacob, that is what about Joseph, that is about Moses, all these things. But when we come all the way to book of Judges, look like the plan of salvation is already gone, because everybody is doing whatever pleases into their own eyes. In the midst of that confusion, you get the ray of hope that about the book of Ruth. Why that book is over there? That tells us that actually it is not, the story is not at over. It is not at over. So God provided that is needed. But in comparison to Elimelech in his life, that may not be a big thing actually. But in the bigger picture of God, he was coming into the plan of salvation also. That is what Ruth's choice that came. She became the great grandmother of even Jesus herself, himself. That why this was God's providential care that happened. So what God's providence, what these people trusted? They believed that God is concerned about the tiniest details of our life. Not only that, God uses everything and he will not waste anything at all. That is the nature of God. You know, we are living in abundance, so we don't care. We just throw away things actually very easily. In this country, you know, millions or billions of tons of food is thrown away every day because that is not useful anymore at all. Because we are living in that condition. But God will not waste anything at all. Remember the small story when Jesus fed the people with the fish and the bread? What he said? Throw away the rest of the things to the trash? No. Collect all those things. God will not waste anything, even your tears, even your experiences that you go through your life. You may even not understand everything why it is, but God will not waste any of those things. God knows what he is doing. Once David said like, Lord, store my tears in the bottle. Is it not in your book? So God knows everything that we go through into our lives. And ultimately, God does everything for his glory and for our good. And doing by transforming us into the image of his son, Jesus Christ. And we may not know this everything as it is. So the tragedies that may not make any sense, but God knows what it is going through and he is able to do it. The scripture repeat that truth again and again and again. We live and move and our very being is in him. And without his knowledge, nothing happens. So we are with him at all times. In him, all things hold together. He upholds the universe by his power. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3 that we read. So these people, those who live by faith, and they are still living, even when they are dead, how they believed and trusted in the providence of God. In the providence of God. Not only that, how did they live when they trusted God then? The second thing that we see, what they did in verse 13 and 14 that we see, they are convinced of this world is not their home. They are convinced that this is not their permanent home at all. Look at these people, what are they talking about themselves? They say that they only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, and they admitted that they were aliens and strangers. Then the KJV says that they convinced themselves, or they admitted themselves, that they were pilgrims and strangers. Pilgrims and strangers, that is the same word, identical word, pilgrim and stranger. But what is the difference? But there is a difference also there. What is the difference? A pilgrim is a person who is going for a religious expedition or for a journey. That's what they're doing. So they have a higher ambition, or there is a different standard. So they are going. And the pilgrim is a person who is traveling. They have not reached their destiny or object yet. Who is a stranger then? Stranger is all of us in one way, we can say. A stranger is a person who found a place to stay, but they know that this is not their home, this is not their culture. Or we can say the resident alien. Now, how many of you hold a green card actually? That is what it means actually. We are a stranger. We are here, but we know that we are not belongs to this place. That is what we are. We try to be American as much as we can. But end of the day, we lick our finger. We eat things. We do all kinds of things actually. End of the day, who we are? We are somebody from somewhere actually. We can act as much as we want to actually. We will never become that, because we don't come from this place at all. That is what we see. We are strangers. We are aliens in this place. So our position is strangers in this world. That is the scriptural truth that the Bible teaches. Who are we? We don't belong to this place. Our position. Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 and 21. Paul says this, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body, that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself. So where is our citizenship? Our citizenship is in heaven. We are holding a resident alien card as long as we are living in this place. Paul said in another place, as we read the other day, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 6 through 8, so are we always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased rather to be absent from body and be present with the Lord. Paul says this, as long as we are living in this earthly body, where are we now? We are away from our home. One day when we die, what happened? Immediately the same moment we are going to be with the Lord. So death for a believer and unbeliever is two different things. Because for the death is, we are going to be our home. That is what Paul calls about his own death as a departure. I am just leaving this place. That is what he says. So this our position is here today. We are strangers in this world. Our position. So how do we live here then? We are strangers and we act also as strangers here. So we unfortunately have a problem here. We think that the world have to admit all of your value system. We think that they have to cheer when you say things. Say, you know, your value system should be the world value system. When they are not doing it, we are concerned. You know, we become conservative and we think that everybody is going to be conservative. We cannot expect any of those things at all. Why? Because we are strangers here. We are strangers here. We cannot stay in this world at all. So there is a fundamental difference between a godly man and a worldly man. There is a fundamental difference. What is that difference? The worldly man, they come from this world. Jesus told them, you are the children of the devil. That may be very offensive to say it, but that is what Jesus said. You are the children of this devil, but we are the children of God. So God is our Father. So what happened now? Because of that, the people came from the world and the father is the devil. So they express the nature of the devil and of this world. But the Bible says, Peter said in, we are the partakers of the divine nature. We are the partakers of the divine nature. What happened then? We act and react and our ambitions, our goals are different. Why? Because we are the children of God. That is the difference. That is the identity that we have on this earth. Then how do we speak then? Even our language, our accent, that shows, right? We all speak English actually, but many times we have to write and show them actually what we meant actually to many people, because many things we say they don't understand at all. We try to tell them why your accent betrays us that we don't come to this place. And as a Christian, sometimes even though people go through backsliding as a Christian, still their language is different actually. Remember that Peter denied Jesus. How do these people know that he is with Jesus? They said that, no, your accent betrays you. You say that I don't know him. Not only the accent from Galilean slang actually, I believe that being with Jesus for 3.5 years, Peter even started to talk like Jesus. And they look at him and said, no, you look like him, you talk like him. Remember that this is who we are. Don't expect, don't act and react like the world. Because we are different. The world did not understand us because the world didn't understand Jesus either. The Jesus, the Son of God, who lived in this world, walked through this world and showed the miracles and ministered to these people, they didn't understand. Do you think that they are going to understand you and me? Jesus said that in John chapter 15 verse 8. If the world hates you, keep in mind that they hated me first. So if you get the recommendation and the comment from the world, be careful, there is something wrong with that. If you are going through persecution, that is where you know that you are standing for the Lord and standing for the kingdom. That is what is right. As a citizen or this country or this world. I have my right, I have the things, I have the freedom, all kinds of things I can expect. But as a Christian, none of those things are nothing matter to me at all. If somebody is going to throw me to jail for my values or the scriptural stand that we take, it's all right. We don't have to fight for that at all, because we can't do anything about it, because we don't belong to this world at all. We can't expect the world is going to treat us like them. No, we are different. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 and 2, the famous verse that we know. No, what a great love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called as His children. That is what we are. The world did not recognize us because they did not know Him. So that is our identity. Remember that. As long as we are living in this world, things are different, because we don't belong to this place. We are passing through this place. These people consider themselves, even when they are rich people, you know, God has given them everything. Even when they are living in the promised land, the scripture tells us that they lived in tents. What is a tent means? The uniqueness of Abraham's life was this. Abraham always lived in tent, built an altar. That was the standout about Abraham. The tent and altar, no matter where he was going. That is what he did. They considered themselves, we have to move out from this place at any time. That is the way they all lived. So the second characteristics of these people, they convinced themselves and knew that this world is not their permanent home. How do we live in this world now? Number three, how did they live? Their pursuit was for heaven. They were looking forward for heaven. These people were 14. People who say such a thing show that they are looking for a country of their own. That means this country they're living is not their own country. They are looking for a country of their own. They are looking for something else. The entire Bible is about journey, actually, right? It is all about journey. Abraham traveled from Ur to the promised land. Then later that we, the people of Israel, they traveled. Joseph traveled back to Egypt. The people went along with him, 70 of them. After 430 years, they traveled back. That is a journey that we see. And they settled down. And later, because of their disobedience, they traveled back to captivity again. Then God brought them back again into Jerusalem. So this is all about journey that we see. Then we talk about Jesus. He journeyed from heaven to this earth. And He lived in Nazareth, traveled in Galilee, went to Jerusalem, and died and buried and rose again from the air. And He went back to heaven. He journeyed back to heaven. And He appointed the apostles. What they did? They traveled all over the world. So remember that our life is a journey. This is not our destiny. We are not arrived yet. So in this journey, don't be surprised by the things that happens in your life. When tragedies hit us, we are struck by that and we are sorrowed by that. We go through these difficulties in our life. But remember that, why these things? Because we are not home yet. As long as you are living here, enjoy the homecomings and do the things that need to be done here. But always remind ourselves that we are just a journey. We are not arrived yet. We are not arrived yet. This is not our home. That is what these people have done. They were looking forward always. They were not looking backward. The Hebrews, the author says that if they had the opportunity, they could have gone back. But they didn't do it. What did they do rather? They were always pursuing. Their quest was moving forward, knowing that this is not their permanent home. Then how did they live then? Verse 15. The next thing, characteristics of these people. They lived by a different set of standards. Verse 15. They lived by a different set of standards. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. What happened to these people? Remember that not only they got saved and, you know, they are looking for a country and doing nothing. No, they evaluated things. They evaluated things. Their choices were based upon eternity. Let me ask you this question. Actually, when you go to buy something, how do you buy it? You look for the best guarantee. Make sure you buy from Costco, because you can return after 3 generations, you know. So we do that. And, you know, to save $20, $5, $10, we buy something that lasts for
Ever. I think that there is no surprise that the country is in a turmoil actually, because the Americans buy it and throw it away every other week, right? So they can buy, so the economy is good. We come actually, we'll buy something for the next three generations. You know, same bed, we'll never throw it away at all. We try to save it. All plastic bags, even we save it, we think that we are going to use it, right? We will try to use all these tiny things, how careful we spend our money, because we buy something that should last for ever. The question is then, if that is the case, how do we make our choices depend upon our eternity then? How do we make our choice in life then? This is what this, these people were not just waiting, okay, one day God is going to come and take us home. We have this insurance of going heaven, not to hell. And they're living in hell. No, they were evaluating everything. Every decision they made. Look at Hebrew 11 itself. You get time, just this chapter itself you read. Every decision they made. They evaluated how this will affect their eternity. That's what they did. Abraham could have lived in the comfortable place. You Google it actually. The place of Ur was a place had running water those days. Running water those days. That means it was a civilized place. And Abraham left that civilized, comfortable place and business and going somewhere not knowing where he was going. Why? Because he knew that this is temporary. Other is eternal. Moses, the man who took all these degrees from Egypt, he was raised in the Egyptian palace, all these privileges, he had the opportunity, the best packet he can get actually, he can be somebody big in Egypt. That is where he was. But what he did? He evaluated all these things, the bonus, the vacation, all the packets, everything put together, compared to the reproach of the slaves. But he weighed those things and finally came back to the conclusion that yes, all these things are good. How long? For a season. The pleasures of sin is just for a season. Don't think that the sin has no pleasure. Yes, it is. There is pleasure for that. But how long is the question? It is just for a season. But the joy with the Lord lasts for ever. So Moses calculated. Every person here we see, they were not only just waiting passively with their life, rather they are evaluating every decision they make. How do we make decisions in life? People are confused always. Always we come and ask this question, what is God's will? We talk about that some other time. But simply I will say that every decision that we make, we have to evaluate based upon how this will affect my eternity. Whether it is your job or your marriage or your career or your house or whatever that it is. How this is going to affect my eternal thing. What is my perspective? You know the famous quote that Jim Elliot said. He is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. He is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Many things that we think that we can hold on to that will go. These people still speaking even when they are dead. Why? Because they made eternal choices. They made eternal choices. We learned yesterday, choices has consequences. It has eternal consequences. These people, those who lived by faith, how did they live? They lived knowing that there is a day is going to come. All the rewards may not get it right now, right here. Don't think that all the time. We read this again and again. All these people were still living by faith. Even when they died, they did not receive the things promised. We only get excited and encouraged when we say that, don't worry, all your prayers will be answered. I don't know, it is encouragement or discouragement. I read so many places, many of the prayers are not answered at all. I don't know how to encourage you. Many of the prayers, Paul's prayer was not answered. The man who was healed by Jesus, he said, I want to follow. He said, no, you want to come. Even the devil's prayer, Jesus answered in that context in Mark chapter 5. But his prayer was not answered. Jesus' prayer was not answered. So I don't know, this is encouragement or discouragement. But remember that God in his infinite wisdom, he has a plan for all these things. But doesn't matter here how it matters. It matters the day to come, remember that. That is the way we have to see things. All the things that we see in every person, those who accomplished today, Wimbledon. Who was this champion 20 years ago? Anybody remember? Who was the champion of last year of Olympic thing? Anybody remember? Who was the president 2-3 times ago? Remember? Bill Clinton. Yeah, you may remember that. Before that, who was it? Who cares? That is all life is all about.
That is all. Remember that. These people evaluated thing. Make decision based upon how that affect eternity. Because your car, your job, your degree, your money, your home, all these things are only for a time being. It will be done. These people evaluated. They lived and died with a different hope. And there we read it again and again what it says. They say that they are looking for a country. They are looking for a country. Okay, a country of their own. They keep move forward with that assurance, with that persuasion in their heart. And it says that if they had an opportunity, they had enough opportunity to go back. Remember that it has the enough opportunity to go back. Quitters always have an excuse. You know, you see people like that. If you have to give, there are 100 different excuses for that. If you want to love, 1,000 different excuses for that. There is always a reason for not to do things. But try to find out a reason why we want to do it. These people have the opportunity if they want to go back. Things were not easy for them even when God called them. Do you think that Abraham's life was very comfortable? No. He came with the uncertainties after uncertainties. Came from one place. God called him. He left everything and walked with the God. Where did he end up? In famine. You know, after 25, then he had to go back to Egypt. And there he had to lie about his wife. He come back from all these places. How long? 25 long years. Do you think that those years were very, very easy? No. God gave the dream to Joseph. How comfortable his life was after that. Very wonderful. From one promotion to another. One was from home to the pit. From there to Potiphar. From there to prison. Prison back to here. This was not easy at all. And God didn't tell them, this is what I am going to do, you know, this day and this and that date and all. None of those promises are given. But God, there is one thing that we see in the story of Joseph. Joseph is not the hero. God was the hero. The Lord was with him. The Lord was with him. Remember these people, they look at for a different perspective. They have a different hope. And as Spurgeon said, our expectations are our largest possessions. The promises of God is our largest possessions in life. They live for that even when they didn't get many of those things. And finally, what happened because of this? These people trusted in the providence of God. They convinced that they don't belong to this place. And they lived with a different set of standards. And they died with a different hope. And because of that, what happened? Verse 16. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Look at the comment that they received from God. What did they happen? God was not ashamed to call us their God. God's name is identified along with these people. We read in the scripture again and again, God is a God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. From generation to generation, these people's name were identified along with Jesus, with God. What it means? God was not ashamed to call us their God. And that's a question we have to ask ourselves actually. Is God is ashamed about ourselves if we identify with God? Why? Because these people lived with a different set of agenda, goal, hope, standard, knowing that they don't belong to this place. Unexpected things happened into their lives. But they didn't just throw away the towel and went back. Rather, they hold on to the promise of God. And knowing that this world is not our world. This is not the permanent place. We cannot expect to be comfortable in this place. Because we are just passing through. When you all travel in the train, I believe in India and all. Not here, Amtrak here. In the train. You remember that? You know, Prem was not here. You ask actually, Bombay. I heard actually, I scared of Bombay somehow. I don't know. You know, you stand there, they will take you in the train. That's the way that makes sense of people. They travel to place to place. In the train, you think that, okay, let me, you know, start some business over here or do other things. No, we know that we are going to get out and get out of the place. That is the mentality of a believer. This is what these people did. And then, what God did for them then? Not only God was not ashamed of them, God prepared a city for them. John chapter 14, verse 1 and 2. Jesus said, "Do not your heart be troubled. Believe in me. I am going to prepare a place for you." We talk about Friday, about heaven and hell. Remember that we should be talking about these things, not only about the things about this world. be excited about where we are going. Read about it, meditate upon it. And Paul said as a command to Colossians chapter 3, think about the things above. So that is what a Christian is. He talked about he's going through this this place, but this is not our permanent home. We always talk about our home. You know, many of you are here 30, 40 years even now actually, you know, what is happening? When we want to go home, in few minutes we become Indians all of a sudden, right? In few minutes actually, I mean, how many years all these people live here actually? The moment we land there, we are a totally different place after all these years, right? Why it happened? Because that is our home. I think we can easily identify it as immigrants, this text actually. This is not our permanent home. What happened to these people then? So how do we apply these principles in our life? Look at these people one more time. They challenge the things or the people that we put our trust in. What is our confidence is in today? Where do we put our trust? Job said in Job chapter 13 verse 15, even though he slay me, I will hope in him. Even though he slay me, I will hope in him. Where do we put our confidence and trust? In people, in things, in our stock, in our circumstances, in our ability, in our strength, you know, in our things that we have, in our assets, or in other things that we be, the people that we know. Where do we put our confidence? These people, they will have no one else actually. They were just strangers going through a foreign land. That is the way they lived actually. That is what we, who we are. All of us are, no matter how much you are settled here. We are just passing through this place. These people challenge where we put our confidence. And they confront our fearfulness into our lives. Many times we do not stand for God or godly principles. Why? Because we are more concerned about our own reputation than God. You know, someone said that one of the Bible teachers said like this about Jesus' character. You know, whenever people attack Jesus about him, said all kinds of things. They said he is illegitimate son. He talked about he is the leader of the devils. He using all kinds of things, all the language. You know what was Jesus' response to all those things? Nothing. He didn't say even a word at all. Even he was standing before the Sanhedrin, even before Pilate, he didn't even open his mouth at all. But we read a couple of places, Jesus was so furious, the righteous indignation, and he was just throwing away things actually. In John chapter 2 and all, what was happening there? He said, this is my father's house, you made it to the den of thieves. There he was angry. Angry for what? Angry for the name of God, for the glory of God, about his father's house and his kingdom. He was furious. Whenever people attack him, he didn't say anything at all. Unfortunately, many of us are the other way actually. You know, the ICE is killing people like chickens every single day. And we just flip over the channel because it is too hard to see for us. We go to the cartoons actually, that is easy. Because that is not affecting us at all because it is not our children. You know, the government passed all kinds of laws. As long as none of us are affected, we don't worry about that at all. But anybody say anything against me, I make sure that I will kill them, right? We get angry all of a sudden. We should be other way. These people, they walk through as aliens and strangers. You know, as a stranger in a foreign land, you have no right at all. That's where they lived. So they didn't fight for any of those rights. And still, they stood for godly principles. They stood for godly principles. That is what challenges us today. The hope God has given to us, knowing that we don't belong to this world. And not only that, what happened to these people, what they are doing. They are rebuking our materialism. You know, one of the things we always have to remind ourselves, especially we are living in an affluent society, we can easily lose track of who God is, what he has done. We become more concerned about the things, the comfort that we have. So it is okay, it is good to go once in a while for a mission or other places and see that how much God has blessed us. You need to understand that. You know, because we want the better, bigger and more. That is a slogan of materialistic world. We sometimes caught up into those things also. We lose the simplicity of gospel sometimes. We forget that some people think that this is the world they are going to live and they will live forever and ever and ever. That is the way. Remember that there is a man in the gospel of Luke that Jesus said. And he had a huge success. He got everything. and his talk made a lot of money and everything he said that look at me now. I made wise choices, smart moves. I made all this money. Let me enjoy, go to Hawaii and Las Vegas and all these things. I am going to have a life like that. What was God's question to him? A fool. If I call you back home today, where you will end? That was the question. Sometimes we forget and we think that this is where we are going to live for ever. Planning is needed. But remember always that the people of Israel that we see when they're traveling, they are ready to move. When the cloud moves, they lift it up. These people challenge our materialism. They inspire our obedience. Let us pray that God will help us to live a life that is totally yielded to him, knowing that this is not our permanent home. We have a different hope. Why? We know that, you know, we mourn. Paul said to Thessalonians, don't grieve as the other people. So grieving is process of part of our life. But we don't grieve like the other people, those who have no hope. And we live with a different set of principles. I hope you and I. And the challenge is this. James says that anybody, those who are lover of this world, is an enemy of God. Even we try to be comfortable in this world, try to get the recognition and reputation and rewards from this world, what happened? We are losing a whole lot. That we need to understand. This morning, I just want to encourage you, reminding ourselves every single day, we are aliens, we are strangers, we are pilgrims in this world. And we have a blessed hope. This is not our permanent home. We will go from here one day, today or tomorrow. We don't know when it is going to be. Either by sickness or by accident or by shooting or some way, one or the other. We have to go by old age. All those things may happen or Christ may come before that. We are looking forward for that, this blessed hope. Church, let us be excited about the place that we hope. Go. Let us talk about our home in our conversations. Let us discuss about things that is matter for eternity. Not only just silly jokes and talk about these movies and these kinds of things and waste our time and life. Our life is so short. It is like a breath, as we heard throughout this week. It is like a breath. It is like a flower. It is like a shadow. It may be 70 or 80 or 90. God forbid, not even 100 years, you may leave. What happened after that? The moment you die, you are stepping into eternity, either with God or in eternal torment. That is the reality of life. There is no second chance. There is no second chance in life. Life is like a coin. You can only spend it once. You cannot spend it again. There is no recycling after that. It is over when it is over. That is what life is. We can make a choice here. As children of God, as believers, as a citizens of heaven, remember that this is the only chance and choice for you to live for Christ. In heaven, you don't have to do any of these things as you do here. There is no need of anything. There is no discipleship. There is no things that you do, many things that you do here. You have to carry the cross. This is only opportunity. It's not only about unbelievers. This is more challenging to the believers. So let us pray that this morning, when we hear the sudden death of our dear ones as they go to the Lord, I pray that this should stir up our hearts. Not only we mourn, let us set our priorities right these days. God knows everything that happens in your life. Naomi became a widow, lost her husband, lost her children. But that was not the end of the story. The story continued. God's providential care to bring the Messiah to the world. God chose these people in his divine provision. This morning, many of your tears may not have the answer. And I don't know how to explain to you in any way at all. We are helpless in many occasions as we come like this. But we believe that we have a God who knows all about us from the beginning to the end. Every steps of a righteous man is ordained by him. He knows every star that flung on the sky. He knows every fish
that is the deepest ocean. He knows them by name. He is not really concerned about the big things. He knows all the tiniest details of your life. Trust him this morning. Convince yourself, this is not the permanent home. Sin has its pressure for just a season, but that will be over. Maybe one day or 2 weeks or 1 month or a year maybe. But there is a consequence. There is a payday someday. Church, let us stir up our hearts these days. Do things that matters our eternity and that glorify God. Would you please pray this morning? Let this challenge our materialism. Let this confront our fearfulness. Let us stand for godly principles for God's glory. God does everything beautiful in his time for his glory and for our good. That is what the God that we serve. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Samuel, Jephthah, Samson, Rahab, Ruth, all these people that we read in the scripture, they all live like this. They were looking for a city, for a country of their own. You are an alien here. You are a resident alien here, living here for a while. This is not our world. So don't be identified with things of this world. Don't be excited about the things of this world. Remind yourselves that I am a child of God. My citizenship is in heaven. I have to think about things above and occupy my mind with the things of God at all times. Let us sing the song and let us praise the Lord one more time. Let us convince ourselves one more time. Our hope is in the Lord, not in our circumstances or not in the things. Let us sing unto the Lord.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Would you please pray?